Hello all. Welcome to the presentation on end-of-life care research in India. I am Shravanthi Maya, a PhD scholar under Dr. Mahati Chittim at the Department of Liberal Arts, Indian Institute of Technology, Hyderabad. I'd be walking you through this presentation today on the different types of medical care that are present today are briefly categorized into 1. Curative care, which has supportive care, and the types of cases in it are patients who have a serious or life-threatening disease. The goal is to prevent or treat disease symptoms, treatment side effects, and address the psychological, social, and spiritual problems related to a disease or its treatment. Palliative care, the types of cases are patients with advanced progressive illness, and the goal is to manage pain and other symptoms and to provide psychological, social, and spiritual support. The second is non-curative care, which is end-of-life care or EOL care. The types of cases are patients with advanced progressive and incurable disease, and the goal is to manage disease-related pain and other symptoms and to provide psychological, social, spiritual, and practical support. Terminal care, the types of cases are patients who have only hours or days before death. The goal is to manage disease-related symptoms and ensure dignity in death. You can see that most of them are kind of seeming as if they're overlapping, but as the patient is going through those stages, at those particular stages, they are given that particular kind of care which they are in need of. Going ahead, let's see what does the continuum of care look like. The continuum of care begins from screening, diagnosis, active disease-directed treatment, minimal disease-directed treatment, and no disease-directed treatment, end-of-life care, death, and bereavement. The course of illness has the palliative care beginning from when the active disease-directed treatment is also involved, whereas EOL comes after no disease-directed treatment, and post-EOL and death, there is bereavement. This is how the course of illness goes ahead. The steps that are involved in end-of-life care are step 1, discussions as the end-of-life approaches, which has to be both open and honest communication. Step 2, assessment, care planning and reviewing. Step 3, the coordination of care of individual patients has to be very patient and individualized. Step 4, delivery of high quality services in different settings. And step 5, care in the last days of life, which has to focus on their needs, their preferences, and provide support. Care after death, the care of end-of-life care doesn't end just with the demise of the patient, but it also goes over to the family and supporting them too. The statistics in cancer throughout the world today range at cancer incidence being at 14.1 million, people living with cancer at 32.6 million, and there are about 8 million new cases per year, and the death is at 8.2 million. The cases in need of palliative care are about 20.4 million, and in the developing countries, the cancer incidence is at about 15.6 million. And the need for palliation in developing countries is 78% of the adults are in need and 98% of children are in need of palliation in the developing countries. The psycho-oncology research in end-of-life care goes to be categorized into 4 different domains, of which decision-making and communication is the first one, under which we have topics like end-of-life decision-making in 6 European countries, a descriptive study done by Heidi et al. In 2003, the prognostic disclosure to patients with cancer near the end-of-life by Lamott and in 2001, discussions among patients with advanced cancer and factors considered important at the end-of-life care by patients, family, physicians and other care providers, study done by Karen in 2000. Under the broad domain of psychological, emotional and spiritual well-being, we have religiousness and spiritual support among advanced cancer patients in association with end-of-life treatment, preferences and quality of life, study done by Balboni in 2007. Dignity therapy, a psychotherapeutic technique for patients near the end-of-life, and prevalence of depression, anxiety and adjustment disorders in oncological, hematological and palliative care settings, a meta-analysis of 94 interview-based studies done in 2011. Under the broad domain of family and social support, we have family perspectives on end-of-life care at the last place of care, burdens of family caregiving at the end of life, the challenges of quality cancer care for family caregivers, study done by Barbara et al. In 2008. Under the broad domain of children and end-of-life, we have symptoms and sufferings at the end of life in children with cancer. Easing of suffering in children with cancer at the end of life, is care really changing? And preferences for end-of-life care for children with cancer. end-of-life care training kits used worldwide. These are the kits that have been developed in order to either train the trainers or to assess how well the trainers have been trained in order to provide end-of-life care. The first kit being the palliative care toolkits and training manual files. This was developed by the Worldwide Hospice Palliative Care Alliance in 2009. This kit contains structured teaching modules and resources to help the trainers explore and learn the materials contained in the toolkit. It includes ideas and suggestions for those who are training and information about teaching methods for those with some experience in end-of-life care. The second being the end-of-life care quality assessment tool developed by the National Institute for Health and Care Excellence in 2014. It taps the services and settings which are delivered by the health and the social care staff in end-of-life care of the adults who are approaching end-of-life. This not only provides care to the patient but also to the family and to the carers involved in end-of-life care. And the third, evaluation toolkit assessing outcomes of end-of-life care learning events, was done by Broadhurst and Fall and the University of Nottingham. They saw this in the areas of East Midlands, where they provided many educational opportunities and trainings to the trainers. And then this evaluation kit helped them to assess how the end-of-life care core competencies were present among the trainers. Evaluation of Train the Trainers, End-of-Life Care Education Model. It was developed by Goodman, Meyerhoff, Handley, Smeaton, Amador and Davis and the University of Hertfordshire in 2014. This measures the end-of-life care decision-making process, the uncertainty during end-of-life, the need for end-of-life care and how, where, when and what kind of end-of-life care is actually needed and what is being provided to the patients in reality. The trainers are trained and then they're allowed to go into the community to provide UOL care services. These are some of the most popularly used end-of-life care training kits worldwide. In the same way, we have questionnaires that are used worldwide in end-of-life care research, like a few are listed below. The cancer care quality measures symptoms and end-of-life care done by Lawrence and Lynn in 2006. This measures the assessment and improvement in palliative care and identifying the gaps in palliative care assessment. It is a 59 measure item scale and the type of scale is a Likert scale. And the University Health Consortium, developed by Maxwell in 2004, goes on to measure the psychosocial well-being and regular profile access of the opiate-induced constipation. The opiates here might be morphine, ultrasets, all of which are crucial pain managing medication that are given during end-of-life care, and it is a qualitative assessment that is being done. ACOV, assessing the care of vulnerable elders in their end-of-life care. This bunch of people have developed various quality indicators for various kinds of cancers at various stages among the vulnerable elders, wherein they qualitatively document the issues in end-of-life care and then develop guidelines through the iterative process. So they have tools like quality indicators of pain management, indicators for palliative and UOL in vulnerable elders, and indicators of the care of colorectal cancers in vulnerable elders, and indicators for the care of breast cancers in vulnerable elders. I'm a PhD student doing my PhD in India, so my population would mostly consist of Indian patients in end-of-life care. Hence, let's see through the cancer statistics in India, the challenges that psycho-oncology researchers are facing, and what could be the probable suggestions that could be incorporated into EOL research in India. So the cancer statistics today in India range at 2.5 million being the cancer incidence and about 80,000 new cases being present every year, and the deaths due to cancer being 5,50,000. The new cases that are being diagnosed at stage 3 and stage 4 are at 1 million, and 2/3 of the total cases that come to the hospital are already there. So classifying the psycho-oncology research in India under the decision making and discussions on guidelines broad domain, we have end stage palliative care of head and neck cancers, a study done by Shishodhya et al. In 2015, the use of advanced directives in a population of Asian Indian Hindus, a study done in 2003, and the ethics that are involved in palliative care, study done by Mohanty in 2009, and optimizing patient outcome of equal importance in the palliative care settings, a study done by Parekh et al. In 2015. The psychological and spiritual factors domain has topics like spirituality, distress, depression, anxiety, and quality of life in patients with advanced care, a study done by Kandasamy et al. In 2011. The attitudes of Asian Indian Hindus towards end-of-life care, study done by Deshpande in 2004. General pediatricians' perception of quality of life among pediatric cancer cases receiving palliative care, a study done by the IAPC in 2014. As we've seen that there were questionnaires developed worldwide to measure the end-of-life care quality of life among the patients, there have been questionnaires in India that have being developed right now, and those that are being adapted and tested within the Indian population. For example, we have the WHO quality of life questionnaire, which actually measures the physical, psychological, social relationships and the environmental domains. It's a 26 question item, and the type of scale is a Likert scale. And the relevance of Can Help, a questionnaire, was also checked with the Indian population, done by Ghoshal and Damini in 2015. It identifies unmet needs of end-of-life care among patients and families, a 29-item questionnaire, and the type of scale being a Likert scale. And interestingly, there was an end-of-life care of terminally ill geriatric cancer patients, a scale developed in the northern India by Gupta et al. In 2007, which measures the knowledge, attitude and practices of end-of-life care issues. And the items were 50 physician-relevant items and 20 patient-relevant items, the type of scale being a Likert scale. Going ahead, as we had mentioned earlier, there are significant challenges that the researchers in who are working in psycho-oncology and interested to work in end-of-life care particularly face in India. Grouping them into broader domains, we have the patient-related factors like unreported cases and sample dropouts and patients not considering EOL to be a crucial phase, and the unwillingness to discuss death is a major barrier, and the social desirability. Under the broad topic of family and culture related factors, we have the non-disclosure of prognosis both by the physician and by the caregiver, and the unwillingness to be honest about the poor prognosis both by the caregiver and by the patient, and having to obtain family consent before contacting the patient's hand stands as a big barrier too. Increased fear of abandonment by family members leads to patients not disclosing the truth at many a times. Under the broad domain of medical and public health factors, we have challenges like lack of clarity in staging, thereby making it difficulty in identifying the patients who are actually present in their end of life, and there being no clarity between what palliative care is and what end of life care is. And there are many, almost around above 100 kind of palliative care centers present today throughout the country, and there is no EOL care centers provided. Under the broad domain of social factors, we have patients who do not disclose the truth about their prognosis or about their experiences due to the social stigma of being labeled either as a cancer patient, cancer survivor. And poor medical literacy leads to patients and family members who are unable to describe what they're going through with respect to reaching end-of-life care and how would they be prepared, and so on. Reviewing the literature, reviewing whatever has been hands-on experience at the with the patients, we've come up with few suggestions for the future EOL research in India, like the psychological, emotional and spiritual experiences of patients at end-of-life care, understanding the role of family in medical decision making, examining how effective and feasible the psychological therapies can be, such as dignity therapy, CBTs at end-of-life care, and communication of the prognosis from a multi-stakeholder perspective. Also, how sociocultural reasons for non-disclosure of end-of-life care and how this is related to the patient's overall well-being, and what are the needs during end-of-life care with respect to the patients, and what are the perceptions which public has towards end-of-life care, and meaning-making efforts among patients and family members during end-of-life care, and the concept of death, exploring it and the advanced directives with respect to it. And as we have seen, we were adapting questionnaires from various populations that were done worldwide. Instead, developing Indian questionnaires for the Indian population that could explore topics such as psychological distress at end-of-life care, meaning-making, spiritual well-being and EOL decision-making. Last but not the least, this is from the perspective of a patient about what is important to me at the end of life, my life and after I die. Hence, they want to be cared for and to die where they would like to be, and the involvement of people who are more important to them and who take decisions about their own care, and to be involved as I want to in the decision making about my care, and support for my emotionally, physically, social and spiritual needs, and being able to maintain a normal life and not be treated as a cancer patient, and supporting both the family and the caregivers and those who are important to the patient, and the right people having right access to their wishes and their wills at the right time. Thank you for listening patiently. That is a picture for me of me, for you to understand that I was the voice behind the presentation for so long. You can always get back to Dr. Mahati and me. We have our emails listed for you. You can always get back to us for any queries. Thank you for listening.